Guys, welcome to the final day of the Batch Leads Masterclass presented by me, RJ Bates III. I appreciate you guys being accommodating of the change of the start time. Unfortunately, my son's game did not go the way we wanted it to. They played a team from Quebec that a bunch of French Canadians, they put it on them. Woo! Boy. Our goalie had a rough goal. It was 8-0 final. But Trinity did get a couple of shots on goal, so still proud of him. He's got a second game later this afternoon, so hopefully they do better there. So that being said, today we're going to be just wrapping up everything that we've done with building out the new account. We're going to be doing some texting and see if we can lock up a deal. For those of you that joined me yesterday, you saw that within the first 25 text messages that we sent out, we got someone that was willing to sell the house. And so that was the results of that kind of got a little bit squirrely after we got off the live. His criteria for signing the contract was we needed to go view the property in person. Okay. He's like, listen, I'll sell the house to you, but you got to go see it. So we called our buyer that said, yeah, I want it. They freaked out. They were like, man, that's a great neighborhood. We're definitely interested in buying that property, especially in that neighborhood. So they immediately went out there. They looked at it. They gave us the thumbs up. They said, yeah, we're good to go. Let's do this. Let the seller know, hey, we're ready to proceed. He said, okay, great. Here's my email address. Sent him over the contract. Didn't view the contract. Sent him a text message. Hey, it's sent. No response. I left, went home, sent a text message late last night about 10 p.m. and said, I'm not going to be able to view the contract until tomorrow evening. And then about an hour later, he comes back and says, okay, so here's the deal. I'm giving you the runaround because I'm being given the runaround. Now, that's how the text started off. So I'm a little bit upset by this because I'm like, I'm not giving any runaround. What's happening here? Apparently he's already under contract with someone. And what happened was yesterday, prior to me sending him a text message, that buyer told him, hey, I'm going to have to terminate my contract because I didn't account for the insurance when I was running my numbers or something along those lines. And so the buyer told him, hey, I'm canceling. And then I sent him a text message. So he says, yeah, we're good. I'm now understanding, I think the reason why he said you have to go view the property is because he was waiting for that person to terminate. So last night, that guy came back and said, I'm going to try to find a buyer tomorrow for the property, and if not, then I'll terminate. And so his situation now is I want to go with you, but I can't sign a contract until this other buyer cancels his contract, and he's going to give me an answer today or this evening. So the situation there is we might have a deal, and if we do, we have a buyer for it, so we've got it assigned already, or it's not going to turn out to be a deal because this guy is going to fulfill his contract and actually be able to close. So kind of a unique situation, but again, that's going to happen in this business. So it's not something that we haven't dealt with before. Now, what I did do is I reached out to him and I said, hey, why don't I just call this wholesaler and buy it from him so I don't miss out on the property and everyone's happy? Because my situation is if he's searching for a buyer, we already have a buyer. Why don't I just reach out to him and say, hey, let's JV this, or I could just, give you a 5 or 10 pop on it and then let me make my spread, whatever. Just depending upon how amicable he is to the situation. The seller said he rents out houses. He's hoping to be able to sell to one of his current renters. I guess it's possible, but I think it's somewhat of a long shot. I responded back and I said, it's worth a phone call to just see if he'll work with us or not. So we're going to see if he responds to that and maybe something comes of that. Ideally, the best case scenario is this buyer comes back and just terminates the contract and we could just move forward with getting on our contract ourselves and get it close. So let's see here. I got a contract with the Rappy dude from Baltimore via text from your 50-day challenge. No way. That is so epic. I love it. So if you guys have not seen this, okay, you can view it three different places, okay? I have a TikTok video of this. I have an actual YouTube video that actually shows the entire conversation. And that's probably the best one. I'll have to look up what I called it. I think it was a funny title. But this gentleman in Baltimore, he called me from a text message, and he just starts rapping. I don't know how else to put it. I mean, it was just like he kind of sounded to me, he sounded like Eminem. And so I was like, this is hilarious. And I asked him if he was a rapper, and he said no, but then he kept rapping, and then inevitably he finally told me, yeah, he was. The title of this, the title of the video is "Dude, You're Like the Not Good Version of Eminem," because that's what I said to him. So if you haven't heard that, you got to go check it out. That's awesome that Braxton ended up getting that property under contract. I talked to him back in 2020, so I guess it took a couple of years for him to finally get to the point that he was ready to sell. So good stuff. Here's a good question. How do you estimate repairs and come up with an offer price? Okay. So I get asked this a lot because we're nationwide, right? And so it's like, how do you determine the repairs in, you know, Boston, Massachusetts in comparison to Shreveport, Louisiana, and then, you know, Dallas, Texas, you know, because the cost of labor, the cost of materials is going to be different across the board. Back when I first got started, I was so wrapped up in that our repair value or a repair estimate needed to be so precise, right? But that was also because the fear of understanding where I needed to be from an offer perspective. And that literally went back to, I just wasn't a good closer at that time, okay? I was making offers and not trying to solve people's problems. And what I mean by that is the seller should always be the first person that puts the anchor in the water, okay? They're the person that needs to start the negotiating point, okay? Case in point, yesterday, the seller comes out and he says, my asking price is $102,000. Now, if you just asked me where I would need to be on that property, I probably would have offered more like $110,000 to $120,000. Okay. So going back to your question on the repairs, okay, there are simple generic formulas that you can use in certain areas. So, like good condition, that could be, you know, cosmetic repairs. That's what we consider that. So we're not thinking that we need to replace a roof or any HVAC or anything like that unless they disclose that. Now, we're not going to ask because we don't want to lose that leverage with the seller later on down the road once we have recon done and we actually get offers back from our buyers. But when we go out there and we say, okay, good condition, you know, $25 a square foot, that's like probably the bare minimum, okay? Now, it doesn't matter if that's a flip or a rental, okay? We always want to run our numbers initially as a flip, okay? So $25 a square foot. Now, that's in most areas in the Sun Belt and in the Midwest, okay? Now, if you're talking about the Northeast, Northwest, some of the places, you know, like in California or Miami, places like that, you're going to need to increase that number, okay? But again, it gives you a good baseline. The other thing is if you're basing it off of solid round numbers and you're buying it at a steep enough discount, right? So if I always run my numbers just starting off at 70% of the ARV minus repairs. Now, again, you're never actually going to sell a property at 70% of ARV minus repairs in, say, Phoenix, Arizona. You're going to sell that much closer to 80%. But that allotted range right there helps you in your repair costs as well as your wholesale fee. So don't overthink it. I mean, a solid rule of thumb is if you're somewhere in the range of 50% of the ARV in your offer price, that means you're probably in the right range, unless the property just needs a significant amount of work, right? That's where you start talking about, you know, foundation, structural issues, something along those lines. But again, don't get wrapped up in the analysis paralysis of the repairs, okay? Do you have a cheat sheet for what you just told us on the repair costs? Not really. No, we have a profit calculator that we use. It's just a simple Excel spreadsheet that we created. It's nothing fancy. But at this point, no. And again, because I give my acquisitions guys a lot of freedom, okay? Freedom to have real conversations with people and say, based off of what you're telling me, I think I could be around $50,000 on my asking price. Then we're going to go out and do recon, and we're going to get a better idea of where we need to be. And then the other thing is experience. Like just having conversations with buyers and understanding what they're wanting, where they need to be, and what their actual repair costs are, that's where you start getting much more comfortable in this situation. But again, just don't get wrapped up in that. Like just kind of always understand that there's a pretty large bucket of price range that you can fall in where if you have enough buyers looking at it, they're going to tell you exactly where you need to be. Okay. Let's see here. Here's the link. Alan just posted it for the dude, you're like the not good version of Eminem. Appreciate that, man. Let's see. Daryl says, when you're virtual wholesaling, is it necessary to register my LLC with every state that you intend to do deals within? So first and foremost, I'm not an accountant. I'm not an attorney. I know that there's certain ways that we do things when we do a significant amount of business. In a state, we do set up a specific LLC for that state. But in the one-off scenarios, you know, say like, for example, if I got a deal today in Rhode Island and I assigned it, then I'm going to be using my Texas LLC. I'm not registering it as a foreign entity. Now, again, I don't know if that's correct, right or wrong. I just know that my CPA and my attorneys have not advised me otherwise. And so I lean on them for that. But if that's something that you're overly concerned about, then I would definitely consult those people. I'm not the authority in that. I'm here just to strictly show you how to use batch leads and acquire a shit ton of deals. Okay. So that being said, let's dive into our batch leads account. Last question before I dive in here, I'll answer Gene's question. Can I get away with the base $39 plan and the $69 SMS and the $59 list, or do I need the performance plan? Okay. So that goes back to your goals and your desires and your time availability and your manpower. Okay. For me, no way in hell would I ever sign up for the minimum. Okay. You're talking about that's like what, $150, $160 a month? I mean, we're literally, guys, okay, now think about this for a second, okay? We are talking about a tool that I am showing you exactly how I use to make millions of dollars. And then we want to talk about, do we want to save money and can I get away with, what do you mean get away? I mean, sure. I mean, fuck it, bro. I mean, you can spend $0 on marketing and get away with it and make some money in wholesaling. I want to be the king. I want to be the emperor. I want more. I go to Jesse and I'm like, I need a bigger package. Where's like the enterprise package? That's where I want to be. So my mind just doesn't go to saving money when we're talking about this. I'm also the person that spent $36,000 to sign up for Investor Lift so I could have the power to do that. That was a no-brainer. No questions asked, like, boom, we're doing it, baby. And in this regard, I want to be able to accumulate data. The data is, again, the foundation for Titanium Investments, okay? So there's no way in the world I personally would ever want to have the cheap version of this. I want to go in, and I think that's kind of like, again, you're setting the standard. You're setting the mindset for what your company is going to be. It's like, no, give me the big dog package, and I want to be the guy that does this. Come on here and have the company batch say, can you teach our users how to use our tool? That's where I want to be, because that's where my mindset is. So can you get away with it? I'm sure you can. I can't advise you to do it, because I can only advise you what I do and what I would want to do. And I would never want to do that. Okay. Let's see here. Is it 4 cents per text? No, I pay like 0.75 cents per text or something like that. So I don't know where you got the 4 cents per text. All right. Let's share my screen here. So to reiterate where we are and what we've done so far, okay? We've set up our new account, initial text templates, quick replies. We're good there. We pulled our list. We skip traced it. We got 95% of our records skip trace. We want to come. We sent out a direct mail campaign. We see this is completed. So we sent out to 17 pre-foreclosures, and we sent out to 113 liens, okay? We could always go back and send more or you know, change it up, continue to hit these. But those have been sent out. They will be delivered on June 1st. And then we've got our SMS campaign set up here. Let's go ahead and refresh these KPIs real quick. So we have a 97% delivery rate so far, 23% response rate. Are you guys tracking how I'm doing that? You just hover over, and it gives you your percent right there. So delivery rate, 97%. Response rate, 23%. Okay. And then, of course, we had our one lead. All right, let's click in and let's send some texts out for the day. I did send out 25 right before we jumped live just to kind of get a little bit of a jump start on the day. Let's get some responses here. We did have this one right here that came in last night. What's the offer? I hit them this morning with 4 questions so we could come up with our offer. They haven't responded yet. And then we have our warm lead right here. He hasn't responded to my text that I sent this morning. Another thing that you need to be regularly doing is going to your SMS settings, verifying that the reputation on all of your phone numbers is still positive and safe. Shows you how many texts that you've sent per number. And again, going back to when I was talking about when you want to release the numbers, once the campaign is done, this is where you would come and see the last time that you sent a text message and then also the last time that you received a text message to that actual individual number, okay? So if you wanted to, you could release this one specific number if you knew for a fact that that phone number was dead to you, okay? So this person says no. Again, remember, we need to verify that owner and then not interested. This person says, I will if you put $250,000 cash on the table. So we click on the address and we go to the comps. Let's just see. Nothing in the $250,000 range. Oh, we got two. But obviously, that would be the max. So, not going to be something that we're going to play ball with. Real quick, I need to explain that because what I just did. So to see how I refresh my campaign there, I go to hot lead and then I go back. This is the two statuses that I use. Okay. Now this is very important. Okay. The two statuses that I use inside of my batch leads is hot lead and no status. Okay. Other than that, the only statuses I'm going to use is when I'm killing it and I no longer want to have a conversation. So that would be not interested or wrong number. Okay. This keeps you organized with inside of your batch leads text campaigns. Okay. Now, people will ask, well, what about follow up? What about referring to an agent? What about warm leads? Okay. Now, I don't understand the difference between a cold lead, a warm lead, and a hot lead. Okay. This drives me absolutely batshit bananas. Okay. What temperature does a warm lead become a hot lead? Now, someone the other day said, a warm lead is they want to sell 3 to 6 months, and a hot lead is they want to sell in the next, you know, right now to 3 months. Okay. And that could be a company standard, a company process that you come up with. For me personally, I don't ask them when they want to sell. I ask them, do you want to sell? So again, going back to my flow and the responses that I get, even if they say, hey, I want to sell my house in 3 months, I'm going to try to lock it up right then and there. We can absolutely put a closing date for 120 days from now. That's not a problem. Let's go ahead and get this signed up, put me in the position where I have equitable interest in it, and let's open up escrow. Okay. That's how I handle that. So I don't put things in the warm lead. Okay. And again, it comes back to efficiency within your system. So that's why I only use no status. It stays in no status until they have either told me, no, I don't want to sell. Then it goes to not interested, or you don't have the correct phone number. That goes to wrong number. Or yes, I do want to sell, regardless of the time frame. Then it goes to verified owner, hot lead, boom. So I know at any point in time, I can go into any of my acquisitions reps accounts, and I can go to the status hot lead, and I know that's every single person that has said, yes, I want to sell my house. Otherwise, the no status should be, we haven't gotten the response from them and we don't know if they want to sell their house or not. Okay. So let's see, we have a couple of questions. So Brandon says, are you re-asking questions with sellers if they are not responding? Yeah, I just did that on one of them. You know, hey, any interest in selling this property? So absolutely, you know, on a daily basis, you need to go back and try to resurrect those conversations. Okay. Juan says, do you close out each message and clear your inbox like an email? No, it doesn't clear out. It only clears out when you change status, and then it would exist in that status box. And what do you tag if they haven't replied to it yet? We don't tag anything, okay? Tags are only used when you're pulling your list and it's telling you what the motivating factor is. That's the only thing that you tag. Now, a status, again, was what I just talked about. The two statuses that you should be working within are no status. You haven't got a no or yes from them, yes. Or you got a yes, and it's in hot lead. Okay. Bob says, should you wait, say, 2 weeks after you're done texting the release number in case someone gets back to you later? I don't necessarily wait a full 2 weeks, but again, this comes up to like your own SOPs, right? So if that's going to be your standard operating procedure, then make that. But just make sure that you're firm in it and you understand how you're tracking that and how, who and when are they releasing those phone numbers and then purchasing new phone numbers? That's really the key here. You keeping it for 2 weeks, I think it's a very, I would say less than 1% of the time is someone going to text message you, you know, 10 days after you text them. I mean, it's just so the lifespan of a text message conversation is essentially a day or two. Okay. But if you want to do that just to be safe and not miss out on that, because other people are going to be doing it another way and maybe they do miss out on that response, then I can't blame you for that. Okay. Let's see here. Mark says, would you release a number after running a campaign if it's not spam? Yeah, I would. I'm going to run that campaign because I'm going to move on to another market. Is the other thing. You can only have so many phone numbers now. They're limiting the amount of phone numbers that we purchase. So if you go back to the 50-day challenge, I had like 3,000 phone numbers during that. Okay. Now, because of what's happening with the carriers and everything like that, they limit the amount of phone numbers that you can get per account. So that's another reason why we're getting rid of them, because we're moving to another market and we don't want to limit the amount of phone numbers we can get. Bob says, when is it a lead? Do you export the lead to your CRM and work those leads inside your CRM? So the only time that we move an SMS lead to our CRM is after we've sent them a contract. Otherwise, it is worked with inside of batch leads. Okay. Once we've sent them a contract, we will create that property inside of our CRM. We move it to the status of contract sent. And then we're still going to follow up inside of a batch leads, but the lead, it shows you the lead type as batch lead. So it's signaling to the acquisitions manager, they know they're supposed to work that inside of batch leads. Okay. Alan says, what about following up to nurture the lead and establishing rapport with the seller? Alan, you must be new to me. So nurturing the lead and establishing rapport does not really happen inside of SMS, first and foremost. That's more of like, hey, we're going to be cold calling, or it's a PPC lead or something like that, where we're having the on-phone conversation. But the other thing about it is our mentality here is we're one call kill shots. Okay. We're freaking assassins. We're not the slow, hey, we're going to nurture this and we're going to build rapport and I'm going to find out your cat's name and when your grandkids' baseball game is and all that. Okay. I'm here to solve a problem. Okay. I'm here to buy your house. And do you want to sell it? Okay. Let's talk about it. What's the price? What's the condition? I mean, I'm going to tell you what I can do. You tell me where you want to be. Let's see if we can do business. Okay. That's our whole company's strategy. And if it doesn't work out, then we move on. Okay. Now, are there scenarios where we do the rapport and everything like that? Yeah, we do. But I'm not a huge fan of that. Just being honest with you. I'm not going to be the guy that wastes 45 minutes on a phone conversation. We're going to dedicate about a solid 4.5 minutes to that conversation, and we're going to find out if we can do business or not. And then we're going to move on to another one. And that's what allows us to do the volume that we do, because we're quick and efficient with our conversations and finding out if we're going to be the right fit or not. Okay. Jason says the non-responders go into auto status of no response, correct? He's telling us to not worry about the other statuses because you should be hitting them in another campaign. So yeah, once they respond, it goes to no status. If they don't respond, then it just sits in the all and it just shows your initial text. But we're going to continue to text them. We're going to continue to cold call them, and we're going to own that data forever. So eventually we're going to get a response out of them, probably multiple times one way or another. Let's see here. Bob said, I think you said often you don't even call the lead. What would cause you to call a lead? Very rarely do I call a lead from SMS. It's almost always, if they call me, then we'll have the conversation. A situation that would cause me to do that is that they ask me to call, which is common. You know, they'll say, hey, can you give me a call? It always cracks me up because if someone texts me and I wanted to call, if I wanted to talk to them on the phone, I'm not going to text them back and ask me to call. I would just call them. So I always, that one always cracks me up. Other situations would be, hey, I'm not available right now, but I will be at this point in time. Can you call me? Again, they're asking for it. And then the conversation just goes sideways out of somewhere. Like, for example, if I say, hey, are you looking to sell the property? I am. What you're asking price, $150,000. Okay, I can offer you $140,000. And for whatever reason, it just starts spiraling and they're upset or emotional or whatever. Or they think we're a scam or something along those lines. Then it's like, okay, I got to make sure this person knows I'm real and I'm serious and I can actually perform. So then at that point in time, I would definitely give that person a call. Juan says, can you go over the batch lead setting to receive inbound calls? I will. So let's go back here to our batch leads account. This goes back to day one, Juan. When you go to your SMS settings and you go to market, the call forwarding number that you put here for the market is the phone number that will receive all inbound calls from your SMS. Okay, it's as simple as that. As long as that's the market that you selected for your campaign, which it shows you right here, market Fort Wayne, then any texts that I send for this campaign are going to be receiving those inbound calls to that phone number. Okay. All right, let's go ahead and send some more text out. I wish I could see what this said. This little GIF's got a little, some words on it, but can't see it. Not selling. Andrew says, how did you get my number? So let's click on his address. Let's go to tags, leads. Let's see. He's got a lien of a sewer lien. Pulled a list of owners in the neighborhood. Skip traces, see if those owners may want to sell. Wrong phone number. $250K as is where it is. All right. Let's see what we got going on here. Seems a bit high. All right, so let's check our hot lead, then come back so we can refresh. Boom. So they asked, what's your offer? So I hit them with the quick reply. I can give you an offer fairly quickly if we can go through a couple questions. And before they respond, we hit them with the questions. Verified owner, moved that to hot lead. Not currently. Do you have assignments in the area you're looking to move? We buy all over Fort Wayne and Kendallville. Interesting. How far away? Let's see what we got going on here. So I know we have a deal in Indianapolis. I don't see Kendallville anywhere. There's Kendallville. Okay, so we don't have a deal there, and the only deal that we currently have in Indiana is Indianapolis outside the one. All right, get them to sign up for a buyer's list there. That's cool. I live here and it's good. All right. So, this is one of those good condition ones, right? I'm going to ignore year built. I'm going to ignore square foot. Okay, so that only gave us two comps. We have three beds, less square foot. So we have more bedrooms with less square footage. That feels backwards. And our two comps are $243,000 and $93,000. Okay, we're gonna have to broaden this out to half mile. Hopefully this gives us something. Nothing.
Yes, there is. You can just reply stop to the text message. And that'll.
All right, so we got some more. We're super small, though. Let's verify that square footage.
You're welcome. Have a nice
day. So this is 1,000 square feet here. Let's see when those pictures are taken. Doesn't tell us. I'll be honest with you, that doesn't necessarily look like good condition. Definitely looks like it's going to need a little bit of loving. And what is this in the back? Is that an attached garage? It's got a fireplace. Why would the garage have a fireplace? That's interesting. When was this taken? November 2015. Let's see. So he bought this in December of 2020 for $59,000. Got a conventional mortgage. It was an interfamily transfer, is what it says. So that might have been the reason why he got it for so cheap. The wind. when did this recording date of this lien was 2018. So that lien's probably not there existing anymore. Tax assessed value $68,000. Okay, so we've got a 956 square foot, a smaller lot, way older, sold for $96,000. An 1100 sold for $94,000. I'll tell you this much. I don't love this property. I mean, we're way on the outskirts. This is where we need to be. Let's say, do we think we can get in the low 100s if this is fixed up? It's 100,000. I would probably want to be in the 50K, 60K range. I say grass are green and money is also green. I have too many in my front lawn, so I don't need money for Hannah Street. Neighbor response of the day right there. It's high to reflect the cost of relocation since you're the one approaching me. This is also not a negotiation. Take it or leave it. Tip for next time. Identify yourself as a predatory investor in the first message. So you're pretending to follow up on a call that never happened. Message could be filtered spam right away instead of wasting each other's time. Okay. Thanks. Bye. I'm a predatory investor because I don't want to pay $75,000 above market value. Unique perspective. So, do you guys have any questions about this process? Make sure everything is responded to. Where do you move the ones that just say no wrong number? You select the little status button, and then you select wrong number. It changes it to wrong number status. Brandon, how do you undo the hot lead / not interested status? I can't unselect. What are you wanting to move it to? Are you wanting to move it back to no status? Because I don't think you can do that. Yeah, you can't unselect it. You can't move it back to another status. Once under contract, what status does it get? We just leave it in hot lead because we're still going to use that status to communicate with them during the recon phase and everything else. My 50 to 60K offer, he told me, yeah, you can lose my number now. Boom, baby. That means we made the right offer. So now we ask him, what number did you have in mind? I'm struggling to analyze that one and come up with the correct number. Probably would have been bad if my offer, if I had shot over an offer and he was like, yeah, send me a contract. Okay, so a couple other things in the reporting section. There you go. SMS report. This will show you how many SMS you sent, how many you received, and then also how many phone numbers you purchase. This will also be able to keep track of your weekly numbers, your past month, and your past year. And then you can also put in custom dates. Just kind of keep track of the KPIs of how many you're sending out. This will also be the section in which you want to just verify that you're not sending too many texts out in a day. Roger says, I mean, they just respond with no on the first text. I don't get to send the primary quick reply one out. I just put them in not interested. Yes. That is what you should do. 500 max per day. Yeah, I mean, per account, obviously. And if you want to send more than that, then I would suggest getting a secondary account. That's where you could use just like the base level plan to just be able to send out those, you know, 500 texts. Again, I would not be hard set on that number. I would want to waiver it. Maybe, you know, one day you do 600 and the next day you do like 250 or something like that. The other thing is don't waste days, right? So if you typically don't do marketing on a Saturday or Sunday, I would definitely find a way, even if it's just utilizing a VA or someone on your team where you are sending out text messages during those days. Those are great days to do marketing, as well as just it's an additional, you know, 1,000 texts that you get out in a week where otherwise maybe you wouldn't be sending out text messages. To send out 500 a day, you would only need 3 phone numbers, but you should always be using 5 per campaign. All right, let's go back to my screen. $155K-ish. All right. Ignore your built, ignore the square foot. located within a quarter mile. All right, let's go square foot, 10%. Oh, you got one comp in there. Although it's, you know, 26 years newer and almost twice the size of the lot. It's also, this looks like this could be a fairly main road. This feels like this is its own neighborhood right here. And this is a different neighborhood right here. We'll ask them the questions. Jose Soto is still in jail. All right. Wrong number. Verify none of these down here responded. Nope, we're good. All right, and this is just basically the process of doing this over and over and over again. Brandon says, if you're still in an active combo with seller and that number shows up as spam, you typically drop that number and purchase a new one. What happens with that lead and conversing with him or her? So if I'm in a conversation, I'm not going to drop the number. I'm just going to make sure that I want to get on the phone with them. Because honestly, the conversations with a seller shouldn't last for too long. And if it's absolutely necessary that I need to drop the phone number for whatever reason, because my number has been marked as spam, then yeah, I'm just going to say, hey, can we hop on a quick call? I'm going to call you from my cell phone and then start the conversation from there. And honestly, you could just explain the situation as well. Hey, I'm having to release this phone number. So that being said, what questions do you guys have about the entire process? I mean, at this point in time, that's pretty much everything that we use inside of the batch lead system. It's so powerful when you use it to its full potential, especially on the list pulling and the list stacking and the properties tab. Again, I want you guys as business owners to work yourself where you're spending a vast majority of your time in the properties tab, where you're making the appropriate decisions on what data you are campaigning to and which ones you're not, and making sure you're hyper-focused inside of your text campaigns, and then making sure that you're going after the appropriate motivating factor campaigns and your nationwide ones. Like, that is what's going to differentiate you from, you know, whatever volume you're doing now to, you know, 3-4 times as much. That's where we saw a significant increase, is where I really started diving into that properties tab and spending a good amount of time in there making the appropriate decisions. Juan says, is it uncommon to run an entire campaign and come up empty? Yeah, I would say at this point it's pretty uncommon. I think there's certain markets out there that you're just going to run into that. Idaho, obviously Utah. We all know I've never gotten a deal in Utah. That's the one area. Idaho, Utah, pretty much anything west of Texas is really tough. Those are some of the harder markets. That's why the Midwest and the Sun Belt is so good for us. The Northeast as well. I think you're in Houston, I believe so. Apologize if I'm wrong, but Houston is going to be a tougher market. I mean, that would be like us running a campaign here in Dallas. We don't really do that. You know, the leads that we're going to get here are probably going to come from the cold calling and from PPC and stuff like that. this is a very powerful tool when you're using it in a market like a Fort Wayne, Indiana, or actually Indiana as a whole, that whole state, this works great in. But again, you don't want to give up on specific markets because it's not going to stay that way forever. They're eventually going to change. But yeah, I would say it is uncommon to have a completely empty campaign. All right. Can you rank the tags? I know you said liens are great right now. Liens, bankruptcy, auction, pre-foreclosure, inherited. Those are probably always going to be the best. Can you give us some recommendations for some great markets? So this is like one of the number one questions that people that attend the Titanium Crucible ask me is, can you rank the markets? Or can you tell me where to go to get a deal, essentially? Here's the thing. I hate Kansas City. Can't stand it. But I know people that absolutely crush it in Kansas City. I love Tulsa, Oklahoma. I have students that have sent to Tulsa, Oklahoma, and they have not succeeded. But then they've gone to Kansas City, and they've succeeded. Okay. Markets all have their own personalities. And it's funny to see the conversations are going to be different in each market. The willingness to work with someone that sent them a text message or their motivation and way to sell is going to be different. Then also just your ability to be able to analyze the deal, pull comps in a certain area, you're going to feel more comfortable. So like for me, for an example, I love Little Rock, Arkansas. I can analyze a deal there really well. And we have buyers and we're able to move things. So that's a good market for us. To other people, they might not like it as much. And so that's why it's important for you to go out there and test it. But if you stick to the Midwest and the Sun Belt states, I think that's where you're going to see some great success. And then when you sprinkle in those heavy hitter markets, like the Phoenix, like the Houstons, like the Dallas, that's where you hit home runs. That's where you hit those $40,000, $50,000 assignments in comparison to going to, say, Little Rock and getting a $5,000 to $10,000 assignment. So there is a give and take between those markets, okay? Let's see here. Edgar says, you use your own money for these deals, or are you getting harder private money? We're wholesaling these. I mean, do we take some deals down? Sure. But in this case, we're wholesaling these. Mark says, Coach RJ, your presentation with Batch Platform was 100% value. You guys followed the instructions and highly recommend attending the Crucible and become a Titan. Thank you, Mark. I love you, brother. I appreciate you always supporting me. I'm glad that you guys got value out of this. This was obviously my first go on a masterclass like this. And I thoroughly enjoyed it. Like I said, I'm going to be doing more of them. So I'm glad that you guys got value. Victor asks, I'm in Seattle, a very overheated market. Have you had any luck here? We have done some deals in Seattle. But again, Seattle is west of Texas. So it falls under the, you know, extremely difficult markets. But if you land something, you're going to have a very healthy assignment fee. So it's definitely not a market that I ignore, but it's going to fall in the lines of like the once every 6 months markets. Okay. JC asked, do we do deals in Florida? Absolutely. We love doing deals in Florida. Florida is one of our best states. Actually, I brought this up earlier, but I didn't really explain what you guys were looking at. This map right here is the map of all the deals that we've ever done inside at Titanium Investments. Okay. So we've got our Alaska deals, our Hawaii out here, and we drop our logo in the every address that we do. Now, obviously some of these get covered up once you zoom in, like for example, St. Louis, when you zoom into St. Louis, you really get to see, holy cow, we did some deals down in here. But when you back out, it kind of looks like just one little dot that's just laying on top of each other. So it doesn't really show. Obviously, we've done an astronomical amount here in our hometown of Dallas-Fort Worth. But this gives you a good idea of where we're doing the majority of our deals, right? Obviously, this one little thing in Utah, this was a JV deal that someone gave me to dispo. You know, we've got the one deal that I did in the 50-day challenge in Wyoming, the one deal in North Dakota. We've done a couple in Montana, but you see, these areas right here are extremely tough. You draw a line from DFW here and over, I mean, we're doing good. That's our sweet spot right there. So what I do here, Bob, is I just come in here and I say, you know, 9307 Boat Club Road. That's our office. Boom. Click add to map, and then I just add the little logo on there. So that's our office right there. If y'all ever want to know, does it ever pop up Titanium Investments? It doesn't. It's supposed to. So the Lake House restaurant's underneath us. And I'm sitting. I don't know why my mouse is messing up. I'm sitting right about here. Right now, actually, right where that pin is where I'm sitting. So I can stare out at the lake and a beautiful view. So if you ever want to come to the Titanium Crucible, that's where you'd be coming. So let's see. Eduardo says, do you market in California? If yes, how is that working? Yeah, I mean, we do marketing in California just like we do in Seattle or Vegas or Phoenix or anything else, you know. We have a good friend in Tulare, the Blaine brothers, Brent and Eric Blaine. We do business with them out there. It's difficult. It's not easy. So, I mean, it's California. It's to be expected. It's one of the tougher markets out there. Brandon says, having used Batch for about 2 years, you gave me some incredible nuggets. Thanks for taking all this time out of your schedule this week. You rock. Appreciate it, Brandon. I really appreciate you guys' questions, because to be honest with you, just sitting here and talking to a blank computer screen, it's like, man, I don't know what you guys need help with or don't need help with. So I appreciated all the questions and the engagement. Roger says, I see a lead I tried working that Christian got sent to you guys to Dispo in Hawthorne, Nevada. Yes. Yes. I think we actually have multiple offers on that, Roger. I have to check with Justin. But yeah, man, this training has been fun. It's been fun for me because I'm so passionate about the tool and because of what it's done for us and our business, you know? And hopefully that translates to the same kind of success for you guys. That's why I did this. And took the time. Listen, Cassie is out of town, okay? If you don't know who Cassie is, she's my business partner, and she's out of town. Her grandmother is passing away, so she took a impromptu trip out to Ohio to go do that. My son is out of town at his you know, hockey tournament. Elijah and I are busy working on the biggest closing of our lives on the country club. So this was definitely a task to be able to fit in the masterclass, but I wanted to do this for you guys. I felt like it was important because if Batch was coming to me and they were saying, hey, people need to know how you're utilizing the tool and we want you to go on there, we'll help support you. They did a great job with setting this up on AirMeet. They did a great job with the graphics, getting it out in front of people. I think at the end of the day, we ended up having like 670 people sign up for this. So it was a great turnout. And again, like I said, I just appreciate all of y'all's support in it. Tom asks, how much is the Crucible training? So the Crucible costs $4,997. So that covers your 2 days here at the office. We give you breakfast, we give you lunch, we go axe throwing, it covers all of that. You get some other goodies. As well as you get access to the private Facebook group and then ongoing Monday Zoom calls. Usually those Zoom calls are somewhere between an hour, hour and a half, where you have access to me, Cassie, Elijah, the whole team, Patrick. You can ask us any questions, as well as you have access to a hotline, which is manned by our entire team, and you can ask any questions that you need there. If you need help analyzing a deal or working a JV or whatever you need help with, you have access to that as well. Edgar, what happened to that contract from yesterday? He's under contract with someone else. That other person had told him yesterday morning that they were terminating. So that's why he told us we had to go look at it. We sent our buyer out there. Buyer said, I want it. And then when I sent him the contract, he said, I can't sign it because I'm under contract with someone else. That other person is trying to sell it to someone today. If they don't, then they're going to terminate. And then we'll get the contract. I asked them, hey, can I just talk to the wholesaler and I'll just buy it from the wholesaler? Haven't gotten a response yet on the wholesaler's number. So I don't know if he's just bullshitting me or if it's an actual scenario. So hopefully we get that under contract today. If we don't, we'll just move on and keep working the campaign. All right. All right, guys. I appreciate you guys so much. I appreciate all the support again. And I will get all of the recordings sent out today to you via email. But again, if you signed up for batch using my code, I'm going to re-record this. This weekend, I'm going to come into the office. I'm going to re-record this with no questions, nothing to slow you down. So you have a much cleaner, more precise version of this. And then I'll send those to all the people that have signed up for batch using my code Titanium or the free trial. Either way, I get paid like, you know, enough to get a Starbucks coffee. So hopefully, you know, a couple hundred of you do that so you can feed my addiction. All right. Appreciate it so much, you guys. And stay on the lookout for the next one. I think the next one is going to be on Batch Dialer. Okay. So we'll see you guys then. Appreciate you.